Minister for Housing, Mr. Wynne, and Jerome Wymer, the COVID commander, for the community update on the COVID pandemic for today. There were 246 cases reported today from yesterday of COVID-19. All were locally acquired. Of those, 121 of the cases are linked to known outbreaks and cases. This now takes us to some 1,619 active cases, all but five of those are locally acquired. The age breakdown continues to point to this being a pandemic of the unvaccinated. There were some 252 aged between the ages of 0 and 9, 260 between 10 and 19, 411 aged in their 20s, and 262 aged in their 30s. And when you look at the number of cases under 50, 87% of those cases are under 50 years of age. There are currently 92 people in hospital, 26 are in ICU, and 14 are on a ventilator. In regards to vaccines, yesterday was our highest number for a Sunday of vaccines delivered through our state-run clinics at 26,955. Add to that the work of our GPs, our pharmacists, primary health networks and others. We are looking for a very solid number of vaccines from yesterday. In our state-run clinics, we are now at 2.61 million vaccines being delivered through those clinics. We have now at 60.9% of first doses admitted to people over 16 in Victoria. That's a good number, but it's well on the way to 70. We've just got to keep the work going to get us there as soon as possible. And we are, of course, well on the way to our million target over 5 weeks, but we still have another 316,000 vaccines to go to get us to that milestone. Some 30,000 bookings were made yesterday into the state-run clinics, and that again was a very good number for a Sunday, but there is always more that can be done. There are currently 10,000 available first dose AstraZeneca appointments available, and 1,000 available first dose Pfizer appointments available over the next 7 days. This does not include the priority program for our Year 12 students, which I'll come back to. Just to analyse a bit further the hospitalisation figures and the notion that vaccines not only keep you safe, but are our pathway to supporting our public health system, our hospitals, and getting out of this pandemic. We did a bit of a breakdown again of the vaccinated status of people in hospital. Of the people in hospital yesterday, 13 in hospital were not vaccinated and were not eligible at the time they were diagnosed, under 16-year-olds. 67 in hospital were not vaccinated but had been eligible for the vaccine at the time they were diagnosed. 10 were partially vaccinated. One person was fully vaccinated yesterday, but the good news is that person has been discharged as well enough to go home today. So I can't reiterate this as many times as we possibly can and in as simple terms as we possibly can. This current outbreak is targeting the unvaccinated because that's where the virus will go. Our best way in which to protect ourselves, our family, our community, and to get to the other side of this is to get vaccinated and therefore protect yourself, perhaps even more importantly, do your bit to protect our public health system and make sure that any wave of the unvaccinated protects our public health system. In regards to the school blitz for VCE and final year 11 exams, those bookings opened today and the vaccinations for that start tomorrow and run until the 19th of September. Our parents, carers and families have received communications from the schools over the weekend in particular, some a little bit earlier, including the priority access booking number. So please check your emails or however else you usually get your information from the school, sometimes online, Compass, all sorts of other communication mechanisms that schools engage with their families around, making sure that those final year students get that priority access to get them into the GAT, to get them into their exams as soon as we possibly can. This also picks up our year 11s who are completing their 3-4 subjects can also book from Wednesday. This is making sure that our year 11s and eligible year 11s and 12s get that certainty about making sure that their exams are going to be held, that they get the opportunity to hold the GAT, to participate in exams, and whilst we're doing it, keep both the students and the staff safe. So I just also wanted to use this as an opportunity to just reassert that if you have been vaccinated, it's still important if you show signs of coronavirus to get yourself tested. And whilst you're infinitely better in being protected and reducing your chances of hospitalisation and certainly death, you nonetheless can still, in more limited circumstances, pass the virus on. So it's still important that even as our vaccination levels grow, that we continue to be alert to the virus and to get tested with even the earliest possible symptoms becoming apparent. Before I hand over to Minister Wynne and to Jerome, I'll just point out that with Parliament this week, with multiple Cabinet meetings and subcommittees on this afternoon, we're going to try to limit this particular engagement to about an hour if we possibly can. So, Minister Wynne.
Thanks very much. Can I thank you for the opportunity to announce two important initiatives that we have committed to. The first is a new rent relief package for those who have lost income during recent lockdowns and are in rental hardship as a result. As the Minister has already indicated, the pandemic continues to have a very significant impact on Victorians who have lost work or had their hours reduced and potentially are unable to meet the cost of their rent. This program will provide a one-off grant of up to $1,500 to Victorians who have lost income as a result of the COVID pandemic and are obviously experiencing rental hardship. The one-off payment is for renters paying more than 30% of their income in rent to help maintain them in safe and affordable accommodation. Grants will be targeted to those who have lost at least 20% or more of their income from the pandemic, backdated to the 27th of May 2021. But we're also asking landlords, and the grant will be allocated to the landlord, up to $1,500. But we're also asking the landlords, as they did last year, to show a level of compassion to people who find themselves in, sometimes in very, very desperate circumstances, insecure work, unable to work, their hours, they've lost their hours. And we think that this is an important initiative, a targeted initiative that is actually going to make a significant difference to people's lives, because we absolutely understand just how critical it is that particularly those who are vulnerable have safe, affordable and secure housing in the private rental market. The second element that I am announcing today also is an extension of our homelessness program. As people would be aware, we have been supporting many homeless and rough sleepers now for more than 12 months through this pandemic in hotel accommodation. To date, we have moved out in the order of 1,100 people, households, into longer term and secure housing. But there are still 1,600 people who are in the hotel program. And we want to ensure that this program, which we will extend out till the 30th of June next year, continues to support people, stabilise them, and then give them a pathway out of homelessness. We want to ensure that this record investment that the government is making, and I indicate that it is a further almost $45 million that we are investing in this program, does provide an essential pathway for people into long-term sustainable accommodation going forward, with the supports that people need to maintain their tenancy going forward as well. So these are initiatives that are very much targeted in the first instance to vulnerable workers, clearly who have lost income and find themselves potentially in a vulnerable situation in the private rental market, and obviously an important extension to our homeless program and rough sleeping program. Our state is providing the most comprehensive response to homelessness and rough sleeping of any state in Australia. And indeed, we have had inquiries from overseas of people wanting to understand how our program is working and how they may be able to learn from our experiences here in Victoria. I welcome these two important initiatives because they absolutely go to the heart of protecting some of our most vulnerable in the community. And I think, Martin, I might call upon Jerome now.
Thanks, Minister, and good morning. So 246 new cases of coronavirus in Victoria in the last 24 hours. That takes us to 1,619 active cases of COVID in the community at this point in time. As the Minister has said, this is a pandemic of the young, of essential workers and the unvaccinated, with 83% of all those new cases in the last 24 hours being aged under the age of 50. 121 of those cases have been linked, and we continue to work on acquisition source for 125 of those cases. Of the 246 cases, 129 are in our northern suburbs. In our western suburbs, we have 71 cases. In the southeast, in our southeast, we have 21 cases. In the inner city and inner south, we have 9 cases. In our eastern suburbs, 8 cases. There are 2 cases in the Mornington Peninsula. There is 1 case in Greater Geelong. And there are 4 cases in Shepparton. And 1 case remains under investigation. And that should give us the 246. The geography, of course, is starkly familiar with what we've seen over recent, the last week or so. Over half of our cases, or around half of our cases, are in the northern suburbs. Over a third are in our western suburbs. There are 172 active cases across the entire rest of Melbourne, and we continue to have around 128 cases in the Shepparton area. But again, day 13 testing has gone very well, and we're starting to see that number of cases reduce as we go through day by day. In terms of the other cases today, the 2 cases in the Mornington Peninsula is 1 household in Blairgowrie. We have a connection to primary close contacts of a confirmed case elsewhere in the city, and that household is isolating well. We have 1 case in Greater Geelong. That's a household primary close contact of an existing case we've known about for a while. And again, those isolation protocols are holding together well. The focus really now in terms of the active fronts and the shape and morphology of this particular outbreak is that we're continuing to see significant household transmission, particularly within our northern and western suburbs. We're also seeing significant transition, particularly in small businesses that are embedded in our community. If I look at places like Somerton Road, near Roxburgh Park and Coolaroo, we're seeing a number of small community businesses with very high levels of positive cases, both amongst their customer base and amongst their staff. What we're also seeing, of course, is those remaining essential workers that are moving around our economy. We mentioned construction sites yesterday, 81 active cases now at the Box Hill construction sites. Those essential work sites are such important places for us to protect and to ensure that the very best protocols are in place. And essential workers generally represent both a huge opportunity for us to ensure we maintain strong COVID safe protocols to minimise the onward risk of the community transmission we're seeing, but also a particular vulnerability. If essential workers aren't on top of their symptoms, are not out getting vaccinated and are not testing regularly, that presents a significant risk in terms of onward transmission. So I would urge, please, again, for those communities that are on the front line, those communities in our northern and western suburbs, we now have significant numbers of people working with you in our local public health teams, in our local health services, through councils and a whole range of other community support organisations to help you stay safe, to minimise the risk of transmission from household to household, community to community, and through your key local community services and businesses. To businesses that remain, those essential businesses that are doing such important work, the most important things that, you know, the most important services that we all rely upon, again, please make sure your COVID-safe plans are working and are functioning well, that your staff are healthy and know what to do when they have symptoms, and that you're giving them every support that they need to go and do the right thing. We need to prevent onward transmission within particularly those workplace settings and out of the places where we see the active front at this point in time. In terms of a couple of key areas in terms of exposure over the last 24 hours, we have Pasco Vale Primary School that has 4 active cases, 3 students and a member of staff. There are 93 primary close contacts. The school is now closed and we're working through our normal contact tracing process with that school. We have a security guard at one of our testing stations at Hampstead Road in Maidstone. Who has tested positive. She has had 1 dose of Pfizer, but has contracted it, we understand, from community transmission. Maidstone testing station is closed for today while we do a deep clean, and whilst we continue to test and ensure that the rest of our staff are able to continue to work. That work will happen over the next day or two. And finally, regionally, we've now got 2 separate instances of truck drivers who reside in Victoria, 1 in Maroopna near Shepparton, and 1 in Wodonga that I mentioned yesterday. Both truck drivers have contracted coronavirus, and based on the genomics that we're now seeing from a different source than what is currently active within Victoria. We believe both have acquired their infection interstate in New South Wales in the course of their normal working duties. And again, the testing protocols we've put in place around interstate freight are therefore very important. And my thanks to these 2 drivers for getting tested so regularly, for getting tested immediately when they had symptoms, and for isolating so well. We do have 1 onward case of transmission with the Maroopna driver within their household, but again, that primary close contact was isolating properly. But it highlights again, of course, that whilst we continue to tackle the significant fire front we see here, particularly in Melbourne, we still have the risk of onward acquisition of interstate transmission from elsewhere. And hence my thanks to everybody who's working on those border protocols and all those people who are authorised workers undertaking that regular testing as part of your permit. It is very important that you do so that we minimise the chance of starting new spot fires in other parts of regional Victoria and indeed in Melbourne.